Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us for another episode of the Connecting Greeks podcast. I am Ari, and I am super, super, super excited tonight because Angelo told me of a guest that we're having, and I went in, I did a little bit of background research, and I completely and utterly just geeked out on almost every single one of my favorite things I've ever watched this guy has been in. I'm not going to say any more until I introduce my co-host, Poti. What's up, Poti?
Yasuo Ari.
How are you?
Good, and I'll second to your comments about how exciting our guest is this evening. And I want to also mention that our co-host, Angelo, is probably in a better place than we are.
He's always in a better place.
In a nice Caribbean with the great weather, as opposed to us up here in this raw, rainy weather of New England. Angelo,
what's
how
up,
are you?
Angelo?
Okay, from now on, my name's not Angelo. Look, I go known as Malacas, okay?
Mister?
I want you to refer to me as Malaca. Because that's because what I did today, I thought I was on the West Coast, and I was calling you guys at 5:30 here, and you're, what are you doing? And I said, because we said we're going to interview Peter now. And they go, no, it's only 2:30 in the West Coast. Peter's in. So anyways, it doesn't matter. Good to see you guys, as always, on our Connecting Greeks podcast. And again, we try to bring in interesting guests. And our guest today, not only is he interesting, he's a very good friend of mine and a fellow Canadian. You may not see his face right away, but you know his voice. And he's done everything. He's a comedian, a voiceover actor, an actor, producer, writer, and a proud Greek. And he lives in a beautiful place called Vancouver, Canada. Welcome to Connecting Greeks, Peter Kalamas. Good to have you, Peter.
Nice to be here. I'm not going to lie. When I heard Connecting Greeks, I thought it was a dating site. And, you know, just where Greeks meet other Greeks
know.
To make more Greeks. That would be the slogan. And I'm in.
Hey, the night's still young, my friend. So we don't know where it's going to go. Peter, can I just say, like, what I said in the beginning is 100% truth. I saw your resume and I was like, wow, if I could have chosen to do certain projects, if I had any talent whatsoever, literally it would look like your resume. Like, you have been in some like amazing things, some of my favorite things. And I was just like, wow, this is going to be great. This is going to be cool. I just want to say, like, How did you get into all this? What started you off? When did you know that this was going to be the path?
Well, yeah, I mean, much like Angelo, I'm sure I've never even asked this question, Ange, but I mean, I think comedy starts in your blood early. You know, you're the kid that gets in trouble in class for making other kids laugh, and it's always worth it. It's always worth getting in shit to get a laugh. They'll do it every time. Impressions of the teacher, your friend laugh beside you, it's the best thing in the world. So for me, it started early. I remember being in the playground. I was like, I don't know, 7 or 8 years old. And people would ask, what do you want to be when you grow up? And people, you know, a fireman, a doctor. And I'm like, I want to be a clown. Which make every Greek parent so proud when they start sitting there at the Greek dinner table and they start asking what you want to be, clown. Oh, and the parents dance. And then they slaughter a lamb and everybody's so happy when you say you want to tell jokes.
Yeah, but you know what? Yeah, but you know what? Yeah, seriously, in case your parents haven't seen, like, show them that resume. I can't imagine anybody not being impressed by this. Like, it's just so cool.
No, but hold on, Ari. Here's the thing. It's stupid until you make money at it for Greeks.
Then the Greeks are like,
you make money, well, my son's a voice, he's an actor. Until then, you're going to do what? So it's so funny how it's stupid until you make cash or you're successful. And then all of a sudden, they're bringing virgins at the weddings for you. Yeah, here's my daughter.
It's funny. I was, you know, when my dad was still alive, he got to witnessed me, you know, starting in stand-up and becoming, you know, relatively busy and successful in stand-up and enjoying it and all that stuff. And he would still, they always considered it the side job. It didn't matter how well or how busy I got. It was always the side job, go to university, you know, become a psychologist or something like that. And I remember the day that it landed for my dad. Because he never, you know, Greek dad's not the most open emotionally, you know, as far as, they're manly men. They're manly men.
Yes,
And I remember he told me, or no, my mom told me, he didn't tell me. My mom told me he was outside of the church Sunday, and I think he went out for a smoke, because that's what you do. light a candle, go for smoke. A family acquaintance came over, and I had some commercials on the air or something. And they said, we saw your son in a commercial. You must be so proud. And my dad was like, oh. they're mentioning this at church. This is the
other Greeks mentioned it, then it becomes real.
then it was real. Then it was real. Yeah.
Well, guys, there was a time when I was living in Toronto, Peter was on, I mean, you were doing movies. I would see you in all these great national commercials, like always, you know, across. You'd seem like, you know, with the detergent with the wife at the apartment, usually silly. And you'd see, your face was everywhere. And I know that you know, you have a place in LA and a place in Vancouver. So you go back and forth. And now because of the stupid COVID, we've all been sort of succumbed to be or a place where it's easier to do what you're doing. But I got to ask you, because it's funny. You know, a lot of times when I was living in Toronto before I met you, now I'm going back, we're going back years now.
Yeah.
Because we knew Kevin Fox. We had a lot of same friends that we worked with. So the guys would say to me, and this is only a Greek thing. They go, do you know Peter Kalamas? And I said, you know what? I do know who he is, but we hadn't met yet. And we met with our friend George. And then Peter, we end up, what happens in comedy, you end up working with a lot of the same guys. But I was on the East Coast, you were on the West Coast. Right. So eventually it's only inevitable until we get, you know, we'll end up meeting each other. But it's so funny how I don't think any other nationalities will say, oh, you know that guy. But for Greeks, it's more distinct. Like, I mean, Russell Peters will go to a Greek restaurant in Cincinnati. And if the waiter's fucking Greek, he calls me. Hey, talk to the guy. He's Greek. What do you want me to say to the guy? Hey, how's it going? You know, how's it get done this? I don't know. What do you want me to? And it's, I don't know if you get that, Peter, but they do that. And it doesn't matter, you know, where anywhere you go. And the guy goes, oh, do you know so-and-so? And 9 out of 10 times we end up knowing the guy. I go, no, I do know who, you know. So I think it's interesting how a lot of the people, you know, the same people, although you don't, it's the same with George Strombo. It's the same with, you know, it's a funny how, it's not that big. We're not that big a community. So it's only a matter of time. Like it'll be a church or at somebody's wedding or at a funeral or at a Greek restaurant or something like that, where the guy comes up and says, hey, you know, aren't you the, you know, they kind of say, are they just, what happens? They'll stare at you at a restaurant. I'm sure that's happened to you, where they'll keep staring at you. And they're like, why is the guy staring at me? Because he recognizes you. But sometimes they can't remember where they recognize you from.
Yeah, I mean, I've been to, I go to Greek Days in Vancouver, which is, you know, I'm sure other cities have similar events where it's Greek festival on the Greek street of each city in Vancouver, to Broadway, where all the Greek restaurants are. There's less than there were, obviously, but it's still Greek town to us. So they have a day every day, Greek day, or every year, I should say, Greek Day. And I go down, and I get people that either recognize me or have been to a show or just... or somebody will nudge them, and it's neat. Makes you feel good, right? It's, you go down, because I go and I take my daughter down to support the community, and you know, buy some food and grab a drink and show her some of the culture. And but it's cool that what I just say. One time I got sent up to a comedy show with two other comics, and it was in New Denver, Yukon. And there's no planes fly in. They got a charter. I swear to God, it was like a 6-seater. And it was January 8th or something, just freezing ass cold. It was some rookie pilot guy that had a learner's license, I swear to God. So he had to keep an eye on the ground at all times. That's how he couldn't fly very high. So we thought we were dead. We made it up there. And they go, oh, there's, I wish I could remember the guy's name, but Greek guy had a restaurant there in the middle of New Denver, heard we were coming, came to the show, loved the show, took us back to the restaurant later. They cooked an entire meal for all the comics and the people associated with the show. And we shut the place down at like 2 a.m. or something. And we're like, we're trying to pay. And of course,
your money is not good here.
You know? So, you know, you slip some tips to the staff, like, thank you for taking such amazing care of us. And but it was one of these things, like Anne just talked about, you'd be in the middle of nowhere. And it's like, they hear you're Greek and they're like, there's an instant thing. I mean, this is what your show's kind of based on. It's the connection of Greekness.
It's bringing it together because it's interesting. Your name came up because my daughter watches Barbies.
The Barbie movies. Yeah.
And we're watching a movie and your name came up. Yeah. So I said, whoa, go back up. So I told my daughter, I go, you know, I have a friend of mine that does, who works on this one. And you've done like Care Bears, Eddie. I can't keep up to all the things. You've done so many things, which is awesome.
Yeah.
The whole bunch. But I know from Care Bears, and she goes, you really know him, Daddy? I said, yeah, I do. I go, and it's so funny when you do that. You think, okay, Barbies. Let me tell you something. Barbies is fucking huge. That's huge. Like worldwide huge. It's huge. You know, but that's just one of the things. So it's funny sometimes your name will pop up on something, and it's true what you say about with especially with Greeks. When you go somewhere, the same thing happened in like where was it? New Glasgow, Nova Scotia. And the guy had a pizza parlor and he goes, don't do social media, because he had the wife at home and he had a couple of chicks at the pizza shop. And he goes,
there you go.
We'll go back, we'll make some pizzas. And the other guys were confused, right? They're like, well, the guy says there's nowhere to eat here. I said, no. I got this guy, let's call him Costa. Costa goes, no, we'll go back, we'll make some pizza. And the guy's making pizza, he's playing Greek music, we're drinking. We're there till 2-3 in the morning, and of course. Yeah. And they're looking at me like, and you're right, Peter. No one else will do that but Greeks. Because we love company. We want the company. He was so happy there's another Greek guy there who's doing entertainment. He wants you to come.
I remember Ange told a story once to me, and it was hilarious. And by the way, Ange travels so much, it's like I don't think he slept in the same bed twice in like 20 years. It's like Saddam Hussein's sleeping pattern. It's never in the same place. He keeps moving and running from the mob since the 70s. Yeah. But yeah, I think you said you were, I think, Arab Emirates or something, if I'm getting the story correct.
Yeah.
And you went into a subway, and there was some guy working the subway, and somehow he heard that you were Greek, and he goes, I'm Greek too, but he had a name tag that said Muhammad. And you're like, oh, Muhammad's not really Muhammad. A Greek name. And he goes, well, no, I just put Muhammad on there for the locals.
I remember that.
The blend.
Remember the guys? It's Michalis. Michalis. We got Muhammad. Put Muhammad. You know. And I'm thinking to myself, and then it turns out the guy said I worked there. He owns the place, but he doesn't wanna. You know. It's so funny to me that you can go anywhere in the planet, and now with social media, look, we're all in four different places. I'm on a cruise ship, for crying out loud, somewhere. I don't even know where we are. I didn't even know what time zone I was today. I was calling Ari earlier.
That's what I'm talking about.
Hey, man, come on. Peter's going to be late. And he goes, dude, it's 5:30. I know. We told Peter 5:30. Yeah, in the West Coast. I go, oh, yeah, right, of course. So that's why I changed my name tag today to Malakas, because that's how I feel today. I'm in a Malakas mood. But it's do you find, you know, Peter, it's funny because a lot of people, because we don't come from a culture that necessarily enhances, I'll be delicate with this. We love the arts because, you know, when you look at the classics in the golden age, pretty much it was the Greeks. I feel because our parents had to leave at a difficult times that they always wanted secure jobs. Like, I always say the top of the food chain for Greeks is a doctor. If you're a doctor, you can look like Quasimodo. It doesn't matter. But do you find now, have you seen people like your friends or their kids come up to you? Like, have you influenced people? Because, you know, you do so many amazing, you have such a great talent. And I'm sure people see this. And do you ever get your friends or kids, you know, of their kids and stuff like that? Did they ever come and ask you for advice and stuff like that? Because a lot of people want to do something different, but they're scared.
Right.
Especially from our culture, you know.
Mm-hmm. No, it's true. And not even necessarily Greeks, but friends. And then especially at conventions. I still go to a lot of anime conventions.
Right.
I had done the voice of Goku in Dragon Ball Z, and I still go to numerous conventions for that. I have a bunch coming up, actually. But I've had people come up to the table, you know, where I'm signing and stuff, literally break down in tears because they're like, I used to watch you and listen to you with my dad, who's no longer with me. And the memory that's associated with
right.
it is so meaningful to them. And I always, you know, as an artist, I always feel a little bit strange because I'm like, listen, I don't want to say it was just a job, but it was a job. And I'm so glad that it connected with you, but I can't take credit for it. But I'm so glad that you had such a cool experience with it. And you get all these emotions that come up, right? And same thing at stand-up shows too. Like I've had younger or friends who have kids that are funny and they're like, oh, well, he's interested in telling jokes. And I'm like, well, that's fantastic. What anything I can do to kind of steer you in the right direction, I will. But you're right. The Greeks, they're very traditional.
I
don't know.
Could I correct you? I don't want to correct you, but I'm going to correct you. You said you can't take credit for it. I think you could take a lot of credit for it. I mean, maybe you didn't write the part or maybe you didn't create the whole series, but you embody the character that these people associate with. If you picture like a classic character of like one of your favorite movies or shows or whatever,
right?
And you replace that person with somebody else, it's not the same. It's something special that the actor, you know, you don't always strike gold, but when you do, you got to take a lot of credit for that. And I think a lot of people who connect with what you do would absolutely disagree that you should absolutely take credit for it. So
I appreciate that. I really do. I don't know. Maybe it's
Canadians were humble.
Yeah, maybe that's it. Humble. Maybe that's
we're
it.
All like Americans.
I'd rather that than arrogant. Than it's. I don't know. I've never really. Hopefully, never been that way.
Yes.
But yeah, I'm always. You know what? Thank you for the comment. And it is. You're right. Whoever does a performance brings something to it. And I guess I'm just saying I'm just glad to have had that opportunity and glad yeah, that
it must, the way that, it that must feel so like amazing just to be able to you know people all over the place you've never met and they know you, they know your face or they know your voice and it means something to them. And that's just such a something, you know, I Fotty and I, we're not performers or anything, so we don't really know that. But just thinking about it must be, it's such a great feeling. And hopefully it goes beyond just the job and a paycheck. It goes into like, you know, who you are and what you do and what you bring to the table. And I think that's super cool.
Good point.
One time at a convention, it was a Dallas convention. I'm actually heading there again at the end of April, but it's called KameaCon and it's Dragon Ball Z dedicated only. Really popular and everybody, it's a blast. You know, I'll plug it. It's KameaCon.com. If you go to that site, if you're in Dallas or near the Dallas area or plan something to do, it's a great event. But the coolest thing I ever signed, me and actually Brian Drummond, who voiced Vegeta, we were sitting beside each other we're friends. But Brian goes, oh my God, you got to see this. And the guy came up with a full-size VCR,
whoa,
right? Unplugged, obviously, from home. And he goes, you got to look inside. So I opened up the flap and it's in felt pen. It's like Dragon Ball Z. And him and his brother watched this tape so much, it eventually got stuck in the VCR. And they kept the VCR.
Oh, in the VCR.
And they brought the whole VCR in and we signed the VCR.
Nice.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
And it's like, cool. This is our, he said, he goes, this is our childhood in a you know, metal box right here.
Wow.
So it's pretty cool.
Yeah, man. And
that's pretty
cool. You gotta take credit for that because that's you. That's you. You made that character. That's you.
Thank you. Oh, but happy Greek St. Patrick's Day, by the way.
Miyasu.
There you go.
I don't have my wine though.
Yeah, I'm gearing up. I'm gearing up. There's a Canucks game at 7:30. You know, I've the wife's had a list of stuff for me to do today. I'm like, I'm mellowing out now. Talking to you guys, the Vino Canucks. It's gonna be a good night.
Nice, good for you.
Could I, hey, Angela? Do you want, you have something, or I just
No. I was gonna say. Go ahead, Ari. I'll wait till after.
I don't want to, like, you know, kind of sidetrack, but like, I gotta ask, like, what it was like working on some of these shows, because, like,
yeah,
I'm huge into sci-fi, I'm huge into comedy, and like, you hit like every single mark on some of these shows, like Twilight Zone, Outer right. Women, X-Files,
yeah.
Like, I can't even imagine having anything to do with X-Files. Like, that must be amazing. Do you have any? To you, does it mean the same? Like, are these like extra cool jobs? Were they just standard jobs? Just something you did, or did it mean something? Like, because X-Files was like such a huge, huge show, and Twilight Zone and Outer Limits. These are like amazing shows. Like, what was it like? I would love to just get your
Stargate. He was on Stargate. It's funny you said that, because I was going to say to Peter, he's either in a sci-fi thing or a Christmas show.
Yeah.
It's
a sci-fi Christmas.
Or it would be real dangerous for me, but he was on Riverdale, man. I wouldn't be able to walk around that set, because that's I can't even watch that show.
I'm a huge sci-fi fan. Anyway, like, I really am huge. Like, even everybody goes to bed here at night, I'm watching TV, it's always end up with a sci-fi movie, or watch Blade Runner or Star Wars for the 20th time. And, you know, I thrived on it ever. First Star Wars, this is a cool story. At a birthday party when I was like, I don't know, 9 years old, a friend's mother, God bless her, took us to Star Wars, the original.
Wow.
And as kids, 9 year old, you could tell, like, we lost our minds. Like, we couldn't believe what we were witnessing in a theater for the first time. Like, it was unimaginable how cool it was. And I remember a friend of mine, like, the next day saying, wow, that movie was so cool. I was like, yeah. And he goes, oh man, wouldn't it be great to be Luke Skywalker? And I actually remember saying, no, wouldn't it be great to be Mark Hamill playing Luke Skywalker? And he was looking at me going, you're weird.
So you were technical about it and business minded even from then.
Well, I just thought that the thrill of playing a character like that was something unbelievable. So I was a huge X-Files fan when I got onto X-Files. So that was, I was kind of out a bit at, you know, working with the two leads. And then Angela's mentioning Stargate. I mean, yeah, it's so cool. Like, Angela, you work with some really cool people, and sometimes, you know, it's very unpredictable, and then your agent will call and say, hey, you landed this and you're working with this person. You're like, Jesus, I've geeked out on set before. You try to contain yourself, right? Because, you know,
you try to,
but there's some pretty big name people, right? Sometimes, and you get lucky, and it just, you know, you try to enjoy it and not freak out.
But does it make it harder to be like a fanboy of somebody you're working with, or is it
easier? Yes. I remember I was driving in over the Burrard Street Bridge in Vancouver a number of years ago. My agent calls and he goes, hey, you just got a role. They booked you off a tape, off your reel. And I was like, oh. And he goes, so Monday you just start working with Angelina Jolie. And I'm like, wow. I had to pull over on the other side of the bridge. I'm like, I'm sorry, you broke up. I thought you said Angelina Jolie. And he goes, yeah, yeah. I was like, Jesus. So I worked with her for like 5 days. Directly scenes, you know.
What life?
Life or something
life
like
or it. Something yeah. like it, right?
Yeah.
With Ed, who's your love interest? Ed.
Oh, Ed. Name? I would say Ed Norton. Ed, it's he was the brothers
Burns.
McMullen.
Burns. Ed Burns.
Ed Helms.
Ed Burns.
Ed Burns. Ed Burns.
Edward Burns.
Remember, he plays and she's a reporter. She goes the big
that's
thing.
The one. Yeah.
I remember.
Yeah.
And he was the guy at the network. And you know, Peter. It's funny you said that you went to Star Wars at 9 years old.
Yeah.
When we were seven, after my dad, after church, my dad took us to see The Godfather.
Nice.
And you're like, I just remember it. And I remember Luca
Brasi. Remember? Oh my God.
At 7 fucking years old, we went to The Godfather.
That's hilarious.
You put him in jail today.
So funny. But like you were saying, that there's been numerous instances where, without trying to sound like, hey, I would work with this person, literally I was geeking out, like Morgan Freeman. I had got to a scene with him in this movie, and it was like, sometimes you get the movie and you're like, oh, those are the stars, but until you get the script, you don't know who you're working with.
Yeah.
And I remember, it's like, you know, I'm sitting there and there was another actor friend of mine who was in the same scene, and we're just, you could tell both of us are like, I'm just Morgan Freeman.
Course,
you know, he introduces himself and he's like, ah, Morgan, what's your name? Jesus Christ, he sounds exactly the same.
That's so funny.
Yeah. That's amazing.
Yeah, no kidding. It's funny because, you know, you're right. You don't know. Everybody thinks that you know. You don't know. You don't know if you're going to be left. I've been cut out of a lot of films.
Yeah.
you did the scene with the guy. And then you got, you know, I remember bringing this girl to the theater in Toronto. Going, this is my, oh, shit. Oh, yeah, it was not there. You know, and they go, were you really in this movie? I go, I was, but I mean, I'm not. I didn't make the cut. You know, so that can happen sometimes, but it's so true because you're, well, 1 minute you're sitting there, you look over, and then it's like Robert De Niro, or like you said, Angelina Jolie, and you're like, and you're supposed to be a professional actor, so you try not to get excited, but you're like, fuck, it's Angelina Jolie, man. You're just staring at her or something, you know, anything.
Well, I remember right around the Angelina Jolie time, I remember if you had like celebrity crushes, it would have been, you know, I thought Angelina Jolie was stunning, and also Salma Hayek. In the same year, about 2 months apart, worked with Angelina Jolie, and then I got a role in a movie and got to work with Salma Hayek. And I'm like, I got to just think about more people that I'd like to work with, because this is rolling pretty good.
Was that after she did Dusk Till Dawn or before?
Before.
Okay, because if I worked with Salma Hayek after I saw Dusk Till Dawn, I wouldn't be able to. That was like the most amazing.
Hey, she looks great. Oh, yeah. She's been in her 50s and she still looks great.
Yep. And she was very, very nice. Both of them were extremely nice. Extremely nice.
It's just, it must be like an amazing experience just to be on set. I mean, working with these amazing people is cool, but like being on set to me and in my limited, like, knowledge of being on a set, it's like a fairy tale land. It's like this, you just get transported to this new place. I mean, it must be so cool to do that for a living.
It is, and I remember I was in Happy Gilmore, and if you see the film, you'd see me, I don't say a word, and they didn't tell me that my scenes until what I'm just talking about. They had a private screening in Vancouver of the film because so many Vancouver people worked on it. And they go, oh, it's a private screen. And I'm like, hey, wait, but my scenes were chronologically coming up near the end of the film. So I'm waiting. I'm like, oh, it's coming up. And then credits. Fuck. They didn't tell me. They didn't say anything. And then
they don't tell you anything.
But if, here's the thing. If they came out with, I think it's a 15-year anniversary Happy Gilmore box set or something, or anniversary edition DVD. And they have deleted scenes on there, and you can see my scenes. So they do exist, and I can watch them. So if you're ever bored one night and you want to flick through and find them, they exist somewhere, so they're real.
You gotta, hey, Peter, where did they film Happy Gilmore? Was that filmed in Vancouver, or L.A.?
Vancouver.
In Vancouver, right? Yeah. Now, the big scene – now, this is the other thing I just read today. I don't know if you – do you know Ryan Reynolds? Have you met him?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I was best friends with his brother. So growing up, I mean, Ryan was the annoying kid who, you know, we tried to get rid of all the time.
Oh, like you legit know him.
Right.
Yeah, no, I was like,
because best today, with
yeah. Wow.
With the, I know there was a connection. And yeah. I know that today, Ryan came out and said his favorite restaurant in Vancouver is Minerva. Mm. It's all over the news today. So everybody's calling me going, you know, I know where Minerva is. It's on... Fourth Avenue. It's Broadway, right?
Is it Broadway or Fourth Avenue? I haven't been for a while, but I know this.
Yes, I haven't been a long time. So he came out today, and Ryan likes Greek food. And it's so funny how, you know, he's become this, you know, with Deadpool, and the guy's done amazing stuff, you know? And it's so funny how, you know, people, I think he went to school with somebody. And, yeah.
Can I give you a quick fun fact?
Yeah.
So Ryan Reynolds, I think, started on a sitcom called Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place. The writer, creator of that show was a delivery driver for a pizza place when he went to Tufts University, which is right near where I lived. And that restaurant that the creator of the show worked at, that based the show on, was a restaurant that I, years later, owned myself.
No way. That's
so
cool.
That's like my weird connection to Ryan Reynolds. The creator of that show was actually part of
Two Guys, a Girl, and a Pizza Place.
Yeah. Right?
Two Guys,
that, that a Girl. His, that place. Was his big kind of network debut.
Yeah,
he had done a couple of like young adult kind of action series or a mystical kind of series in Vancouver prior to that.
Was that like his first thing, like in that broke him like wide, or
yeah,
the United States at least?
Right, that was his big kind of American television debut, was Two Guys, Girl, and a Pizza. That was his big one.
I just want to say, like, he's like considered one of like the best looking guys in the sex symbol and all this stuff. But when he was young, man, to me he looked kind of goofy. I don't know if you guys.
Yeah, women love him.
To see this and
women love him, dude. Don't my wife goes nuts when she sees
him. My wife would drop me in a second if he walked in the room. My sister saw him on the street.
He's okay.
filming in Boston, and she was like the most beautiful
woman. He's a good looking boy. He's a good looking boy.
Good looking.
He's another good guy. You know, it's like thankfully there's few. Or maybe I've been lucky.
Not that good looking. Guys good looking.
Yeah, I've worked with very like assholes and people that you really would never want to work with again. I've been very lucky. They do exist, but the majority of people I think are pretty cool.
Yeah, that's
cool. Pretty nice.
Yeah,
it's good to hear that, because you know I get so frustrated so easily with nothing. Imagine like people always like kind of interrupting you or coming during dinner or asking for this and wanting a picture. 99% of the time, I would not want my picture taken. Imagine everybody always asks for a picture. So I could get why you get to that point. So when I hear people are cool in this industry, it hits a little harder, because you have every right to be like a frustrated asshole. And if you're cool, it just means that you're just that much more of a good person.
Yeah. Years ago we were filming, or not filming, we were improvising in Vancouver at Punchlines Comedy Club. It was part of the improv troupe there, in addition to stand-up. It kind of spilt into some improv. But the owner said, Robin Williams is in town and he's filming Jumanji, the original Jumanji.
Oh, wow.
And he's like, oh, he called down and he might come down and improvise with us. And we're like, it's not going to happen. And I remember literally, I was like, oh, yeah, as if he's going to cut. All of a sudden, oh, hello.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, do you mind if I play with you? Do we mind? Do you fucking mind? If sure, I think we can fit you in.
It's like the World Series of
So he improvised with us that night, and you know, place goes bananas. The next day it's all over the news, radio. And the following Wednesday we had improv night. They started lining up at like 4 p.m. for like a 9 o'clock show.
Wow.
Then he didn't show up. So the following week, 80 people in the crowd, he shows up backstage and we're like, oh, we thought you were going to, you know, show up last week. And he's like, well, I was in a cab and I saw the lineup and I kept going. he wasn't there to do, you know, for the masses. He was just, but I mean, and another time he dropped by, because he started dropping by the club, right? I was teaching a comedy course, actually, that Seth Rogen took.
Wow.
I got Seth Rogen stand up in this course that I got hired to teach, and I used to pick him up. He was like 15 years old, pick him up at his house, and you know, started stand up, and he was hilarious out of the gate. You know, it's like,
yeah, he's pretty talented.
I mean, right out of the gate, and it was like his comedic timing and what was funny, what wasn't, was already
good.
In place, right? That there was there wasn't much teaching on my end. It was just like tweaking, like try this and this. Other than that, just do what you just did, because you're hilarious.
Yeah.
Sorry, where was I going with this story? I started with...
No, you're talking, you picked up Seth Rogen.
Robin Williams kept popping in.
Teaching this course, and it was like an 8-week course, and at the end, and it was people from everyday life, realtors, students that would work on a 5-minute set for 8 weeks, and then we had kind of a graduation night. So we did the 8 weeks, and it's our graduation night. So they've invited friends and family. Place is jammed, jammed. And the owner comes up to me. We're only halfway through the show, and he goes, "Robin's here, and he wants to go up. You gotta fire these guys through quick." And I'm like, "This is their first time on stage in front of a crowd. Like, I can't tell them to go quick, and I can't tell them he's here because they're gonna shit themselves, right?" So I was like, "Hey guys, try to stick to your time," you know. And it went on for another hour, and he stayed.
Wow.
Oh, and he stayed. And
he stuck around. And then I remember at the end, I had to think of some kind of interesting intro because I'm introducing Robin Williams. And I go, hey, it was like 2 hour show. And I said, I get up there and I go, "Hey guys, thanks very much for hanging in. And listen, we had this one student who had to quit the course halfway through for some family reasons. And I don't think he's ready, but if you guys want to indulge us, you know, for one more show, you guys got the energy for it?" And they're like, yeah, I guess. Okay, his name is Robin Williams. And he came out, right? I shook his hand, and I swear to God, there was, I think, maybe 3 full seconds of silence where they couldn't believe it. They couldn't fucking believe who was standing in front of them. Wow. And then it was... It was like a 5 minute standing ovation. Like, he had to do this to start because wow. They lost their shit. And then he did an hour.
Wow, that's crazy.
Hey, brilliant.
Yeah, it's crazy.
So Peter, when you look at this is the Vancouver scene. And I got to know there's a lot of great talent, such as yourself, a lot of comedians, actors, Seth Rogen, Ryan Reynolds. Vancouver is so talented and it's got a hotbed of things, but I'm gonna ask you a very serious question.
Yeah.
And this is a serious question.
Yeah.
Are the Vancouver Canucks ever going to win a fucking cup?
Whoa.
Oh, Jesus. When's the last time?
I didn't want to bring it up
because I know it's not real.
Since our existence, I think what the Maple Leafs, what, how have they win one since we've been around? I don't know.
One, yeah.
Maybe a couple in the 70s. Okay. Maybe a few in the 70s. All right. I'll give you that. Okay.
I want Vancouver to win a cup.
This is the bane of my existence. every year the pain is real.
Being from Boston, I won't say anything.
Don't.
Listen, Boston's won cups, Montreal's won cups, Vancouver has some of the best fans in NHL, right? And there was a run there where you guys were winning all the it was like a curse. You kept winning the president's trophies and getting booted out in the first or second round. And I know our buddy George Econ, who's a huge Canuck fan, all those George Urbinos, all Canuck fans, because you're on the other side of the Rockies. So there's no love affair between Vancouver and the rest of Canada when it comes to hockey. And the Vancouver fans know this. Yep. They do not like each other. Never did.
No.
You know, and I was like, right?
No, here's the thing that pisses us off. Because in Canada, the Leafs could, you know, buy or hire a new puck boy, and it's front page news on every sports station in Canada. You know, the Canucks, you know, blow somebody out 10-2. No, it doesn't even make the radar. Not only that, when the Leafs come in, this is what pisses me off. Now you got me fired up. when Toronto plays in Vancouver, they change the game time to a 4:30 start so people in Toronto don't have to stay up late to watch a fucking game. I swear to God.
It's true.
But the opposite happens.
How is that catering
the concession for the one team?
Yeah.
That's not right, guys.
Now my blood is fire.
we're talking about like all these amazing things, and you bring up the hockey, and everybody's getting fired up.
If you want, you know, Ari, you want to get Canadians fired up, and I do this. It's so funny. We do the podcast. And when you're with Canadians, because it's a deep-rooted love of this game. We love it so much, right? And I got friends all over Canada. The only team I don't support, really, is Toronto. I hate them because I'm from Montreal. I grew up in Ottawa. And it's not so much I hate them. I want to see a team win. But Vancouver, to me... because you know they had riots a couple of years ago in Vancouver.
Yeah.
Vancouver, so nice, sushi and Stanley Park. They went mental. They're flipping cars and shit and burning stuff.
No, and I mean, a lot of people from the burbs had come into town for that. We blame them. That's why we make them live there.
There you go.
Yeah.
Up in Burnaby and stuff. But it's so nice. But guys, I don't know if the guys have ever been to British Columbia.
Never.
But let me tell you something. When I travel the world, when you tell people Canada, everybody thinks it's always much. No, the first place they always bring up to me is Vancouver. It's one of the most beautiful places on the earth. And if you go up to all of Vancouver, if you go up to Gros Mountain and Whistler, and they call it supernatural because it really is. It's one of those places that you got to go visit once in your life because it's truly beautiful in every sense of the word.
Yeah, it is.
Except their team sucks.
Very frustrating. Very frustrating.
It's a frustrating thing. So, you know, Peter, I was on a podcast in Arizona. I was doing shows in Arizona. And the guy was talking. They had a hockey podcast in Phoenix. So the guy goes, you want to come and talk? He goes, sure. So I got on the hockey podcast. And this guy's thinking, oh, he's a comic. You know, he's going to add some funny to it. We got into it. Because the guy was telling me how Canada's overrated as a hockey nation and we got better. And I'm like, what? I go, first of all, how many Canadians are playing on the fucking Phoenix Coyotes? And it was the time when Gretzky was the owner coach. I go, look who's coaching it. God of hockey. And you're trying to tell me, Malaka, that you guys are more superior than us in hockey. So we started getting into
That's awesome.
And the guy loved it. And the guy thought, hey, man, I brought you on to be funny about hockey. You're, like, getting irate.
Yeah, no, that's the line.
Hockey? What is it about hockey that gets our blood boiling? What is it?
I remember when we first, you know, started coming down to L.A. more frequently when we had a place down here, I'd wear my Canucks jersey and go to the games. And, I took my wife to this game. And I had like really good seats, lower level and all that. And I was just, anybody wanted to bark at me. What? And she's like, I am never going to a game with you again because you're going to get killed. Because they would start barking at me. And I'm like, wait, do you want me to come up to explain the game? I'll come up and explain. I don't know how I didn't get killed. I didn't know how to get shot.
Well, you know. The reason I bring it up, I was Luch Casimiri, you know Luciano. Yeah. You know Luch. So he has tickets for the Vegas Knights.
Nice.
So Montreal was playing Vegas at that new arena in Vegas.
Yep.
So I went down and we went to see the game. Now Montreal's in last place. They suck this year. They just suck.
It's a bad year.
Luch is going, I'm bringing you to see a slaughter of your team. I said, okay, fair enough. Well, we're in the third period. With 8 minutes left, Montreal's up 3-2. And you can hear a pin drop at the T-Mobile. And I got my big Habs jersey on.
Oh, yeah. Like, I saw photos of you doing it. I saw photos of you posted. I remember that.
And they ended up tying in the end. And then I think Vegas, it was a tie. And they won it in overtime, Vegas. But I said, hey, you guys are like in second place. We're in last place. And we were able to do that. And he goes, you know, my nightmare, because he's a Leafs fan and a Vegas Knights fan. So his nightmare was coming true again. He goes to me, I can't believe it, man. They suck. I go, they do, but that's hockey. They catch wind one game. Anything can happen, you know? Exactly. And it's like, and they're Boston. Oh, in Boston, so I've admired the Boston Bruins because you guys have a good team in Boston. You've always had a good team. And you had great players.
It's just such a tradition. Marchand, if they could just put some like warfarin in the locker room and just eliminate the problem.
Yeah.
Just some rat poison. That's all I'm saying.
That's all.
Speaking of hockey and Boston, though, it's like, of course, since 2011, we lived to hate the Boston Bruins so much more than.
Of course.
Everybody, the Bruins.
I think it was like 1999 or something. I got a commercial and it was for a Chevy van. And this is, you get hit on YouTube too. I found this on YouTube and this, it's amazing. People post everything.
Yeah.
But it was a commercial and I went there and it was a director during the audition, a director I'd worked with. And he goes, yeah, just do this and this. And I was like, yeah, okay. So I did it. And he goes, yeah, I'll see you on set. And I was like, oh, wow, that's nice to say. Maybe he's just, you know, being nice. Anyways, I get it, and it's with Bobby Orr.
Whoa.
So I have to do a commercial with Bobby Orr.
Legend.
I brought the famous shot of him flying through the air. I got it blown up because I'm like, I'll bring it. I don't know if he's into signing. I don't know if he's a nice guy. It seems to be. But we got there, and you know, there we are on the trailer, and he's like, "Hey, how you doing, Bobby Orr?" And I'm like, "I know who you are." and then there was another little kid there, and he goes, "Mr. Orr, would you mind signing this?" And he's like, "Yeah, no problem." And when I heard that, I think I pushed the kid's head out of my way, and I put my thing in. And then he signed my card, and the big blow up thing. I still have it framed. Wow. And then it gets even better. Later on during the shoot, we're outside filming, and the owner of the Canucks at the time shows up to say hi to Bobby Orr. And my friend was also in the commercial, and he goes, "Hey, Bobby, you taking us to the game tonight?" Because a Canucks client. And he goes, yeah. And he goes, "Hey, hold on a sec." Says something to him, and he goes, "Yeah, just write your name down with how many tickets you want."
Oh.
So we each wrote our names with like four beside it. And I remember we went to the Pacific Coliseum, and I cannot tell you who the Canucks played that night, but I got to go to the will call and say, "I believe Bobby Orr left some tickets for me." And they were like, "Yes, sir.
Wow.
Yes, sir. Here you go." And we were on cloud nine in the stands. We were like hooting, hollering. I don't even know if we watched the game. It didn't matter. It's who gave us the tickets to go to the game. And it was one of the coolest games I've ever been to in my life. And it had nothing to do with who was on
the game. How cool is that?
Yeah.
Bobby Orr put you on the will call. Like, how fucking cool is that?
Yeah. Yeah. I believe Bobby Orr left me some tickets.
Yeah. Bobby Orr, O-R-R, Orr?
Yeah.
You know, I did this thing, Peter, in Toronto twice in a lifetime. But the guy's like an angel or something like that. And I played a backhoe operator in the thing. So the guy wanted me to wear, the true story, Toronto Maple Leafs shirt with the hat. So I'm in the trailer. It's like 20-something years ago. And
the guy goes, "Are you ready to go?"
And
say?
"No," we got a problem. And he goes, "What's the problem?" "The shirt, it doesn't fit." No. I can't wear it. The guy goes, "What are you talking about?" I go, "It's just Toronto. I'm not wearing it. Get me any other shirt but this one." He goes, "Are you going to be a problem?" But I can't wear it. My friends see me wearing a Toronto jersey. Oh, it's hell. So the producer came over, one of the producers who's from New York or Boston. I can't remember. And he goes, "What's going on?" I go, "I can't wear the shirt." He goes, "Why?" I go, "Where are you from?" You know, I said to him, "Peter, where are you from?" He goes, "I'm from Boston." I go, "Would you wear a Yankees jersey going fucking Boston?" And he looks at me and he goes, "Get the wardrobe guy. Get another shirt for him." "Would you wear a Yankees shirt in Boston?" "Fuck no." I said, "Same thing for me. I can't wear this shirt."
Oh, man.
"Get somebody else for this shirt. I'm not going to wear it."
That's great.
It's so funny.
You definitely put it in terms that a Bostonian would understand. So
yeah.
We connect through sports, right? I mean, entertainment, sports. Let me ask you, this is a good question right now, because entertainment's changed so much, Peter.
Yeah.
Do you find now that I think that some people think there's this movement that people think entertainers and athletes get paid too much. Right. My theory on that is that we work so hard most of our life to get to a point where we can earn a living at it. I don't think it's a fair assessment. What's your feelings on it? I mean, like, the game changed since COVID happened. A lot of things, TikTok and all that stuff's happened. Well, how do you feel about that?
I think you're bang on accurate that you spend, you know, decades or a lifetime honing something that you try to get good at. And that's the thing. When somebody's good at something, like when you see good acting, you don't notice that they're not really that character. It's just so natural. Mm-hmm. And they're so good. The actor or actress may be so good. It's not supposed to be distracting. When you see a great comedian, you're like, "Oh my God, he's just making this up on the spot." No, Ange and I know that. I mean, you go through years of honing. Sometimes one joke can haunt you sometimes for years. You can't get it working
forever.
Sometimes you get it working. You spent years doing shitty road gigs and getting to where you need to be and making it sound spontaneous. So it's like, yeah, I mean, it's you get paid for putting the hours in that nobody's paid you before, you know. It's like a lifetime training, and hopefully it works out in the end. There's a lot of, we both know, I'm sure, a lot of good comics and actors and performers that never really make it and either drop off, you know, to the side or give it up or, you know, have some sort of tragic end or whatever and never quite get to where they want to be. So I'm thankful I am where I am. You know, there's people that may not be at my level. There's obviously a lot of people way above my level, but I've been able to do what I love to do for decades. And you got to be thankful for that.
And I think the audience is thankful for, you know, like me as a fan, I'm thankful that you do what you do because you brought to life so many things. You were in so many things that I respect and love. And now you're here talking to us. And it's like an amazing experience for me, at least as a fan, you know?
Thank you.
Peter, let me ask you. Do you ever draw, because sometimes I've done it only a few times, where have you ever drawn on your family members? If you got to come up with a character or a voice, do you ever find sometimes it's that Theo or that weird cousin? Have you ever done that where you're thinking, who am I going to think of now? Do you ever draw from your own family or very close experiences?
Oh, yeah. Well, one of my trademark bits used to be like it was about my Greek mother answering the phone, and she only knew a handful of English names, you know, like Matthew, Mark, Luke. That's it. That's it. Just the apostles. You know, my white friends would call up, give her some weird name to deal with, and she'd be freaking out. And she never. So that was always my killer end bit because it always kind of landed. It was personal. When the bit's personal, it seems to land better. People can tell.
Yeah, it always does, doesn't it?
But I've taken advantage of. There was a show called animated show called Class of the Titans. It was an animated show all about young Zeus, you know, as a kid, and they were like a team of young kind of superheroes back in Athenian type days, right? And I remember I read for a bunch of characters and they were like, oh, okay, that's great, thanks for coming. I said, oh, I want to read for Grandma Hercules. And they're like, yeah, sure, no thanks. I said, no, I'm serious. And they're like, okay. And then I just did my yaya, right? That's it. It was just my imitation that I've been doing since I was a kid. Like,
Hercules, what are you doing? Why don't you lay down? You look tired.
And I got the part.
That's awesome.
Got the part. And all these female and, you know, voice actresses were pissed. Like, who got the part of Grandma Hercules? Calamus. That piece of shit.
That's what I'm saying. When you hear it, you know that voice. It's your yeah. But you have that in your head. It's not even an effort. You're drawing it from your brain to your tongue. It's like, that's what I'm saying sometimes. Just the little bit you did, it was like, yeah, you're the yeah. You're the grandmother of Zeus. Okay, you got it.
That's it. And just I don't know. It's and so like, I mean, you do your Gringlish shows, right? Where it's, you know, your combo shows of Greek and English, which are fantastic. And I did a couple of my own. Ange has been doing it for a long time. He's unbelievable at it. But that's where when I was writing for it, I found really reaching in and finding little Greek moments along the way that were fun to discover. You know, reading, doing bits. Like, I think my opening bit used to be, how many Greeks does it take to change a light bulb? And I said, one. But you know damn well that your mother's going to call you and make you feel guilty for not changing it yet. Okay. And then it was just her in the dark going, hey, the cacho dos escotadi, de pirage. Hey,
stinaki, I'm a daughter, I'm a brispe, I'm a nita. Kandi di dulia, so de pirage. De pirage. Oh, so classic. Takomira. That's so good. Yeah, I want to ask.
We know the guilt. We know the guilt.
The guilt.
Yes, I would say when people say, can you draw from guilt? Yes, we're Greek. We know guilt when we're 2 years old. You know,
if there was if there was an Olympics for Greek for mothers, you know, I think the Greek moms and the Jewish moms neck and neck.
Yeah.
Neck and neck. We had gold, silver every time.
It's too
many talents. Peter, Peter, I was,
well,
I want to ask
be close. Yeah, they time 40, you want to ask something.
Yeah, yeah. You know, for us here on the Connecting Greeks, it's a pleasure to be able to connect with Greeks from the diaspora because we share, as you're mentioning right now, so many common experiences. Are you first generation Greek?
My parents were first. I was second.
Second, yeah. Excellent. And did you ever make it back to the homeland on family trips or visiting?
I did. I went back. My last trip was about 2.5 years ago, just prior to the lockdown. And it was hilarious because I visited my aunt and my cousin, and they still to this day they're in a small they're close to Cornifo,
yeah,
right, but they're just outside of it, so it's a little smaller kind of area, and so I rented a car and I'm like, so where do you guys live? What's the address? Then I come address.
Right.
I'm like,
so how do you
how do I find you? That's it. The Greek churches and villages are like the triple A of the area. And there's some guy that will come out from the back with, like, you know, a broom. And you're like,
well, you're so right. Have you ever?
One guy knows everything.
Have you ever tried to send a package to the Horio in Greece?
No.
It's
the same guy that collects.
Awful.
While I was there, they, you know, we didn't want them to cook or go out of their way. And my cousin's like, we'll order food. They go, you know, they got Greek DoorDash now, right?
Yeah.
So she, I swear to God, I'm listening to her order and she goes, deca souvlakia, salata. Είναι το σπίτι με τα κάγκελα, το μπλε. And he found it. And he found it. He shows up on a scooter 10 minutes later.
That's awesome.
Oh, it's fast. No, nothing.
Fucking no.
No GPS, nothing.
Yes. Fascinating.
You call Domino's 30 minutes or less, my ass. These guys, no address.
Oh man.
Peter, I was at my dad's Corneolix party. I go to the guy, I need a ride to the other side. He goes, that's a bow go.
Yeah.
Then I come an Uber and the guy came strapped. He came on a tractor. He came on a tractor. He took me on the fucking tractor over. And it's like Greek Uber. That's a bow go. I thought he had a car.
That's it.
Get a fucking tractor.
Oh, I remember once a few years ago I was there and we went to a panagiri. Right, one of the villages, and it's great, yeah. You know, music going, the wines flowing, all that, and it's out, you know, in the slightly outskirts of the city kind of thing, but hundreds and hundreds of people there, and at one point, got to go to the bathroom, so I asked one of the, what seemed to be one of the organizers at the ticket table, and I was like, puine o cabines, o cabines, sto horasi edo, re, cabines, acuodo, o proedros, el cabines. Like suddenly I was some uppity asshole for asking for a bathroom.
How dare you.
Bathroom.
Oh man. Oh man.
Well, you know what, Putty, let's get to know a little more on the Greek side of him.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, Peter, we do this little fun segment towards the end to get to know you a little more as a Greek.
Hold on, Takangela. DoorDash, Window City, Stakangela.
Takangela, Takangela, εκεί. Έχουμε και ένα σκυλί εκεί. Μην μπεις μέσα.
Sorry, buddy. I'm sorry.
No, that's this is what it's all about, brother. This is what it's all about.
Oh, fuck, man.
Oh, man. Good times. I'm sure we can spend...
You're a funny guy, Kalanis. You're a funny fucker, man. Shit, oh, you man. Made fucking laugh.
So we do this little segment that Foti does to get to know a little more of your Greek side. So, sure. So we're gonna do that since it's a good segue.
Oh man. We could spend another episode just going back and forth. But so Peter, you know, as a Greek Canadian, you know, growing up in a Greek household, was there one favorite dish that you grew up on that was Greek?
The chicken souvlaki. It sounds like a, you know, classic go-to, but everybody's mom is a good cook,
right?
You know, in your family. And you know, like when you go to another person's house, you're always like, oh yeah, it's okay. And she's like, oh, that's horrible. That's horrible. Other Greek moms cooking was disgusting. Your own, fantastic.
Fantastic.
Well, you were conditioned.
On the same note, what was your least favorite Greek dish?
Oh, Easter, the bacha. I don't even know what the hell was in there. Was it intestines, hooves? I don't know what the fuck was in there.
Everything.
It's just like, but when you knew your mom was cooking that, you opened the door and you smelt it, and I used to run away.
Yeah,
it was the most horrible smelling thing. I still have a memory of the smell, and it's horrific.
But yet it's a remedy for hangovers.
Oh, I don't take the headache. You know what? Give me some Tylenol. I'll sweat it out.
Awesome. So you were making some references to Yaya, but you know, as youngsters growing up, we were bombarded with Greek sayings. Any Greek sayings that still stick with you today?
Oh, the sayings. What? My grandmother on my dad's side, she was a nasty piece of work. Obviously, she loved her family, loved her kids, loved the grandkids. But anybody else, they were scared of her.
Oh, nice.
Right? And I remember, this isn't really a saying. I don't know why, but the story, this is taking my thought into the story. But I remember I used to hear stories about how my grandmother would get back at people, you know? And she said one time the neighbor's chickens would like run into her yard. And then she went over and told them, you know, that the chickens are coming over. You got to put up a fence. And they're like, the was on the fence. Two months later, chickens are dead.
Oh, I had a feeling you were going to say that.
It was a mystery poisoning of the chickens. Whoa. To this day, Greek authorities have no idea what happened. But Yaya Kalamis, innocent on all charges. You did not fuck with this woman.
Amazing.
That's awesome.
And the last question we're going to ask you, Peter, you know, as Greeks, you know, we live a pretty dramatic life in all households and we're pretty superstitious. Any superstition that you live by today?
Superstition. You know what? I hate to just say no, but not really.
Yeah, a lot of people do say no. You know, it's, superstition isn't for everybody.
I used to, you know, I grew up with, I mean, my wife is not Greek, and I remember her coming to the dinner table, and it's like right away they'd start doing the mati. She's like, your mother is spitting at me. She loves you. She's trying to protect you. Oh, that's
why nice. She's spitting at me.
Right. Your wife.
Can you imagine? The guy's poor wife. She has no idea what's going on, and people are spitting at her.
No.
You gotta be Greek,
dude. Awesome. I want to say thanks for coming on today, Peter. You're fucking all continued success, buddy. At some point when things settle down, maybe when you're back in LA, we'll get together and do a barbecue. But I really appreciate you coming on the show today. And it just great. The hour went by so fast. It was just,
I know.
It was a lot of fun.
For me also, it was a lot of fun. One thing I don't know how quickly you're turnaround is, but I want to plug an upcoming show that is, I think, very important.
Yes, that's what Ari's going to do that with you now.
Yeah, we're doing a Ukraine benefit. It's going to be in Vancouver, April 9th.
Okay.
It's the website. It just went live. Tickets are selling. It's going to be webcasted. It's called onenightstand.org. Now, it's the number one. Don't spell one. Otherwise, it's just filth. You go to a filth site.
Yeah.
Trust me, I checked. 10 times. But the number one, linkedin.org, and it gives you information for tickets, who's on the show. We got a great lineup of comics. I'm going to do it myself. And also you can actually webcast the show or donate to the cause. And as we all know, it's an extremely important one now, not to end on a more serious note, but I think every day, I mean, for me, every time I watch the news, it's just, you get brought to tears, or you try not to be brought to tears. But any way we can help, and as entertainers, this is one way. You know, Ange has done benefits in the past, and I'm sure will again, but it's something that we can give, a skill that we have. And although you go there and you laugh and all that, it is going to a very good cause that will directly help people getting out. So
that sounds amazing. And yeah, we're gonna have all that information on all of our platforms. We'll have it in the podcast, the video. We run like 10 different platforms with a pretty big audience. We'll put it all over because it is.
Thank you very much.
And you know, I'll also email you after just to make sure all the information is correct and all that. But on that note, I want to say on behalf of all of us at Connecting Greece, thank you so much, Peter. It was amazing talking to you. Me, myself, huge fan of your work, everything that I see. So cool. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you, Forty. Thank you, Angelo.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Peter.
And thank you, guys. Thanks, Peter. And go Canucks, right?
Go Canucks.
Continued success, Peter. And thank you, everybody out there, for watching and listening. The show will be on the podcast and video, and we'll have all the information about Peter and about the benefit. And thank you so much. And we will see you guys all next time. Good night.
Take care, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye, guys. Bye, Pete.
Bye-bye.